Welcome to the pre-drive amble. Some wonderful news. VM, aka the Wildebeest, is back from leave. There we go. And we are heading down towards the southwestern corner of Juma, hoping that Queen Karula puts in an appearance. Had a little bit more rain overnight, and as you can see, the termite alates are out, flying about. Continue the frog hunt in the early morning, but I didn't hear too many frogs last night. As I said last night, or on the sunset safari, I think we're going to need a little bit more rain. Although we did have some overnight, a little bit more rain for the frogs to really come into their own. We need those little water holes to have some grass cover in them. Now, the best and most interesting that happened is, I know the lions were very vocal last night. Jamie's going to go have a look for those. We're looking for leopard. Now, while Jamie and I were preparing the cars this morning, Final Control wanders down and says, we need to come listen to the Juma cam. It sounds like there's a buffalo dying. And we went, that's interesting. If there was a buffalo dying, we would hear it from the cars. And it's quite a distinct sound. So Jamie and I wander up to Final Control in the middle of preparing the vehicles. We got it, our preparation broken. And they're like, wait, you can hear it. It wasn't a buffalo. It was either a dung beetle or a robber fly buzzing around the microphone at the damn cam. So it wasn't a buffalo dying. It was the flutter of insect wings. I hope Final Control's suitably embarrassed at the moment. Yeah. And the hyenas were whooping last night. They did sound quite far to the north of us. Although there was definitely one hyena on Juma, and it managed to steal the rubbish bin out of the DRC again. Oh, I don't know. Maybe we should go to Cheetah Plains this morning, VM. What do you think?
Maybe it's too early.
I don't think it's going to rain again this morning, but others are not as confident as I. Of course, Tingano was seen on Torchwood last night, so he could quite easily have meandered into Juma. So I think we'll check the southern boundary and then the eastern boundary. And of course, there's been lots of wild dogs around, so fingers crossed they might make an appearance as well. So far, just the odd impala that we have meandered past. It's incredible how, with a bit of rain, all the dust settled, and your visibility is quite impressive in terms of distance. Now, will today be the first day of the first baby impala? And the race is on to see who sees the first baby impala of the year.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
And on another magical live safari adventure, as we eagerly anticipate the birth of the impala lambs and all other exciting things of the African bush, this is Safari Live. And a very good morning to all of you, and welcome on the Sunrise Safari. My name is Jamie, if you have just joined us, and this is Brian on camera with me, of course, always accompanied by the Morning Thumb. We're coming to you live from Juma, Arethusa, and Cheetah Plains Game Reserve in the Sabi Sand in the Greater Kruger National Park area of South Africa. And because we are live, it also means that we are interactive, which means send through your questions on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or email through to questions@wildearth.tv. And I have to tell you, on the Sunrise Safari, I don't think a sunrise is imminent, but actually it might turn out to be a beautiful morning after all. We had even more rain last night, which is of course always a pleasure out here, as it feeds the thirsty landscape. Now the sun is just struggling to break through the clouds and rise up above the horizon. What a stunning morning this is going to be. I think we might even have a little bit more rain at some point further or later on today, but hopefully we'll be able to carry on throughout the Sunrise Safari. And as I said, of course, each and every single impala herd that we stop at, we are going to be having a look to see whether or not there are any little ones. And it doesn't look as though this herd has got any babies with it just yet, but for those of you who perhaps missed the Sunset Safari, the first impala lamb has been seen in the Sabi Sand, not by us on our live drives, and we have something of a bet going as to when we're going to see the first little one on our live safaris. I've said the 15th of November for sentimental reasons, since a friend of mine is due to have a baby on the 15th of November. Brian, what do you think?
I say tomorrow.
You say tomorrow. You might not be that far off. I mean, look at that female there that's nibbling in the tree. Some of them are rotund, to say the least. And definitely almost on the verge of popping. So Marisha, you say today is the day that you voted that they were going to have their babies, so let us find one. It's amazing how at this time of year we stop for each and every single impala herd and give it, if not a long glance, then at least a cursory glance to see whether or not there's any little pitter-patter of tiny impala hooves. I don't hear any pitter-pattering, Brian. Not just yet. But we are going to be getting closer and closer to the start. Oh, somebody's got an itchy leg. We are definitely going to be getting closer and closer to the arrival of the little ones. For our new viewers, it is always an incredibly exciting time. There is nothing quite like the sight of the spring load of impala lambs, all born roughly within a few days of each other, or usually around a few days of each other, scampering around, forming their little creches, looking wobbly and gorgeous. The other thing that's happened, of course, is that this time for the impala's lives has confused the males terribly. Last night I was listening to the sounds of them just before I went to bed, and the constant grunting sounds of impalas in rut, which is, of course, totally confused on their part. And the rams sort of take in all of the hormones that are flying about with these pregnancies and think that it's time to mate, which it isn't. And I'm afraid to say that they're barking quite literally up the wrong tree. Hey, mister, you're definitely not going to be getting luck with any of these females anytime soon. It is, however, highly entertaining to watch. Right, well, since there's no impala babies here, I think it's time to go off in search of other things. And of course, on a morning like this morning, post-rain, there's also the prospect of all sorts of exciting things. Frogs, reptiles, Who knows what else we could find? I've noticed a few flying ants or termites, and there might be birds feeding upon them. Now, that's what we're going to be looking for today, some of the smaller things as well. And while we trundle along, let's head across to Brent so that he can say a proper good morning to you all.
Welcome to a beautifully crisp and clear cloudy morning here in the African bush. My name is Brent Leo Smith. I have Vim on camera back from leave, and we're way down, on the south. I was looking for one of these yesterday, but I didn't have any luck. But this morning we have found a big one. Crossing the road at a snail's pace. Here we go, the giant land snail. And he's moving at high speed. Now, a lot of the giant land snails are carnivorous, and one of their favorite foods is other snails. And you can see he's in high gear. I know a few of you have been waiting, so the wet weather has brought out the giant land snail. And you can see how he's moving, it's incredible. So minor little contractions along his single foot that sort of just creep along. And of course there's that sticky substance they leave behind. And you can see how the sand is sticking to his underbelly. That's a big one, and an old one, judging by its shell. You can see his antennae there. Almost think we should have some giant land snail races. What do you think, Vim? Nah, might take a bit of time. Bye, snail. Okay, so we are looking for any sign of Queen Karula. Oh, Vim's heard something. Vim said he might have heard some alarm calls. Oh, I hear a lion. Sounds like possibly down towards the Arethusa airstrip. Just listen again. So those lions are somewhere close to Jamie, if Jamie can use that lion audio. So everyone just switches off and listens. I would say that sounds almost like it's at Juma, at the camp. But there was another lion audio from down in Arethusa as well. Oh, kudu alarm calling. That's almost certainly Queen Karula. Hopefully she's coming this way. She is down, or whatever those kudu alarming at are, to the south of us. Now, Celine, who's 4 years old, says she would love to see lions this morning. Celine, I think there's a good chance. I think Jamie's probably hot on the trail of those calls. Now, whatever that kudu was alarm calling is directly opposite us here, but still quite deep within our neighboring property. Come on, come on. Probably say about 800 meters or so in. Now it's gamble time. Do we wait it out? Or do we keep looking for something else? Let me see on the radio quickly. Morning mobile stations. Any station in the east copy me? I think they're all still tucked up in bed. Well, I think what we're going to do is we're going to go down towards the Mwachi River and then maybe take a swing back up here a little later. Okay, well, Celine, who's four, is looking forward to seeing some lions. So let's go to Jamie and see how her lion hunt is going.
Well, Celine, I'm definitely going to be out and about looking for lions. On that note, just bear with me one moment, because as soon as Brent called in that there was the sound of lions roaring, I stopped and switched off the vehicle and was trying to listen. From where we are, I can't hear them. The only thing I can hear is a ground hornbill. So what I want to do is just contact Brent on the Game Drive channel quickly, and I'll stop here where there's a nice-ish view of the clouds and the horizon. And I'll try and find out exactly. Oh my goodness, how beautiful. What a stunning morning. Yes, let's stop here, I think. Take a moment to take in the scenery. Brent for Jamie. Look at the Drakensberg Mountains on the horizon. Whereabouts did that audio come from? Okay, copy. I'm going to come along Sandy Patch and then make my way along Gari Cut Line. Stunning silhouettes of the Drakensberg Mountains. In the distance, the highest point, Mrupskop, where all sorts of antennas sit at the top, apparently were there from the days of a more troubled history of South Africa, communicating across the oceans, making sure that we were not under threat from, at the time, what was considered to be the terrible communist threat. Now, they just sit up there, relatively untouched. It is a beautiful spot. For those of you who ever come to visit this area, I would strongly, strongly recommend going up to the top of Mrupskop. It's the most amazing ecosystem all of itself. Rainforest in the middle, and then you go up to the top and you get fynbos, which is a type of plant, or a plant type of vegetation type, that really you only find in Cape Town and on the top of Mrupskop. It's quite fascinating. Now, for those of you that ever find yourself in the area, I would definitely head up in that direction. They say, I've been up there, I've never managed it, but they say on a clear day and with binoculars you can actually see the ocean, which is a good couple of hundred kilometers away from where we are at the moment. You can also look down into the Blyde River Canyon, which is the largest green canyon in the world. Don't know what it looks like at the moment though, after the drought. Hopefully, I think there's actually been enough rain to start refilling the Blyde River Dam coming through down the mountains. But on to things a little bit closer to home. I think we're going to go and try and find those lions, whatever else we happen to encounter along the way. Days like today are perfect for looking for big cats. And because it's a nice and cold and slightly cloudy and rainy, and James in Ireland, thank you very much for sending that through. And James in Ireland said that he loves the work that we do, and that trundle is James's new favorite word. Trundle, of course, is something, it has become one of my fallback words. I have a few of them. When I first started working, it was the word so. And I've gone through quite a few of them throughout the year and a half that I've been working for Wild Earth. My latest one is that being said. I'm trying to break the that being said habit, which apparently I say all the time. So James, thanks very much for sending that through. We're going to trundle along. It is a good word though. I think it's perfectly descriptive of what it is we do. When we don't have a plan and we're not necessarily going straight to one sighting or another, we trundle. We go off and search for all kinds of interesting things. And particularly after the rain, which is where I was going with that sentence before I got distracted, with the big cats in particular, all of their scent marks, all of their territorial markings have been washed away. And last night we were treated to the incredible sound of one of the Birmingham boys roaring, it was Tino, I believe, roaring right next to the vehicle, Mfumo joined in with him. And there's nothing quite like that sound vibrating in your chest when a lion roars right next to you. And he immediately set off and was marking his territory all the way along Twin Dams Road, which runs right through the center of Juma. So the leopards, the lions, even the cheetah are, male cheetah at least, females are not really territorial, but out marking their territory and reaffirming that this is their land. And this is, and of course it's cool, which means that all of the animals are likely to be slightly more active. You'll find that the elephants are more playful. The impala and the antelope are more energetic. You can hardly blame them. This lovely drop in temperature, it was 21 degrees centigrade this morning, so 69 in Fahrenheit. Beautiful day. And of course everything feels fresh and clean. You've got the smell of petrichor. James is one of James's favorite words. And petrichor in the air. The smell of the earth after the rain. Does also mean that some of the animals do go into hiding, which they appear to be doing very, very well this morning. And I really, honestly, my mission today is just to find a tortoise. I would really like to just see a tortoise. I haven't seen one this season. No, that's not true. I saw one tortoise on quarantine a couple of weeks ago. But I haven't seen any leopard tortoises. And they're one of my favorite animals to stop and watch. Okay, better do the cursory glance. Excuse me. Do we have to send any congratulations to any of you? Baby cards, balloons, teddy bears? Nope. Not yet. And a question on the subject of brand new babies, and I'm afraid to say we are going to be talking about babies quite a lot in the next 2 months, because of course is the peak season of birth for a lot of the different antelope. What was the name again, Curse? Turtle? Tricking turtle. Tricking turtle. Turtle tricking. Almost, Brian. Almost. And tricking turtle, I felt like was a lovely name, but turtle tricking. Turtle trekking with an E, not an I. He wants to know how long the gestation period is for an impala. So their mating season is around the beginning of June, July, August, September, October, November. It's roughly about, just realized I've got oil all over my hands. Roughly about 5 or so months. And what will happen is that we'll get births of the impalas initially, impala lambs, and then there'll be about a month and a half gap, and then there'll be some, quite literally what we would say in South Africa, laat lammetjies, late little lambs, which a laat lammetjie in Afrikaans refers to a child that's born as a little bit of a surprise quite late in its parents' life. That's a laat lammetjie. And what happens is, if a ewe doesn't fall pregnant straight away, she almost immediately comes back into oestrus, and the males mate with her once again, and then you essentially get two peaks of breeding, the first births and then the second births. So, you know, if you happen to miss out on the first set of lambs, which you shouldn't, because it'll be quite a few days where that will be spending watching them, and if you happen to miss out on the first set of births, there's always the second to look forward to. And, of course, after rain, jumping around a little bit, but after the rain, one of the other things that we always enjoy doing is checking out the water holes. Not because there's going to be any animals there. Chances are there are actually going to be no animals there, except perhaps the odd hippo and bird, but simply to get an idea of just how much rain we have had. Let's go and see what's happening at Sydney's dam. It's quite hard to tell with Sydney's Dam because we can't get right up close. And I actually haven't seen Sydney's Dam since before the rain. Let's go and investigate. Then we'll go look for the lions, I promise. Sydney's dam actually doesn't look all that changed. In fact, it might even be less than when I left, it looks like. You can actually see the catfish are starting to flop about in there as it gets more shallow. And Sydney's waterhole is one of the few that never dried up completely. But now look at this. Obviously there was not as much rain here as there was in other places. You can see the catfish, those puddles and ripples in the water. That's the catfish starting to, having to move up to the surface for oxygen, because as the water gets less and less and the sort of the density of fish gets higher, they start to struggle for oxygen and they start to have to move, start having to move to the surface to supplement. Right, we're going to carry on, see if we can catch up with those lions. Let's head across to Brent, who's got a feathered friend for you all.
It's the first great spotted cuckoo of the year. I have seen them, but this is the first one we've managed to get on camera. It should be a good one for a lot of bird lists. One of the slightly less common, more common cuckoo species, the great spotted cuckoo. A very pretty bird. Now, all the cuckoos are brood parasites. Now, it's quite a big cuckoo, and I wonder if anyone can guess what birds the great spotted cuckoo parasitizes. So, of course, brood parasite means they kick the eggs of other birds out of their nests, lay their own, and... Oh, there he comes. He's coming closer to us. He's going to land right next to us. He's going to fly past us. There he goes. Oh, on the ground. Ah, termites. That's the only reason we're going to see them on the ground. Let me try move a little bit. Oh, there we go. He's running along. Must be hunting termites. Here we go. Happy cuckoo. So, as I was saying, they choose normally certain species to parasitize, and I wonder if anyone knows what the most common species for the great spotted cuckoo to parasitize is. Remember the black cuckoo, which we find around the drainage lines, they parasitize boboes or southern boo-boos, the shrike families, and this one doesn't, so I wonder if anyone can guess what species the great spotted cuckoo parasitizes. If you know, send your answers through to questions at Wild Earth. Oh, termite hunting. Questions at wildearth.tv. Or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. Oh, lion calling again. Those lions are outside of our traverse area. Those sound like they're in Chitwa Chitwa. Chris Rogue says it's a brood parasite to magpie shrikes. That is correct. It's one of the 11 species that has been recorded as a brood parasite. But in this area, it's mostly starlings. Oh, wonderful camera work, Vim. Oh, and off he goes. Wow, what a lovely sighting of a not too often seen cuckoo. So apparently, well, it's the second one seen. Apparently, you saw one with Byron. That was my first one. Dave and I spent about an hour trying to get one on camera as it kept flying up and down, having an argument with another one. So, let me know how many cuckoo species out of all the cuckoo species that we get have we seen so far. I know for sure we've seen the African. Now, the great spotted, the black. What other ones? Oh, red-chested, I'm presuming. And classes and Deirdrecks, I'm not sure yet. But let me know how many cuckoo species have we seen on the live drives this wet season so far. So with this rain and whatnot, there's almost zero dust in the air. And the long distance visibility is absolutely incredible. Now there we go, we're looking off to the southwest. You can see the clouds over the Drakensberg Mountains. Isn't that beautiful? More lions roaring, but they sound like they're in Torchwood. They're just lions roaring everywhere. Those sound like they could be on Cheetah Cut Line. So it sounds like there's lions up here, there's lions there, and there's lions over there. Well, we're going to keep going. Now, as we're looking at the Drakensberg in the distance, Jane is wondering, are there any animals that are endemic to the Drakensberg? Well, there's some bird species, such as the Drakensberg siskin. There's some fish species that are endemic to certain mountain streams. But animals as such are not really endemic to the Drakensberg. You'll find some species up there and further on the high fault that we don't get down here on the low fault, such as black wildebeest, orobie, fall rebok, which is a type of reedback, a mountain reedback. So there are a few species, but nothing particularly endemic. There are endemic rodents up in the mountains to certain parts of the Drakensberg, but generally further to the south, in KwaZulu-Natal, where the Drakensberg is quite a lot higher than here. I just want to see where Jamie is. Jamie. Jamie, there's more lion audio everywhere. There's some audio down south on Chitwa. They sound like there's some in Torchwood, and others might be sort of Cheetah Cut Line, Buffalo Cut Line. What'd you say? Oh, well spotted, VM. There was some earlier, but the last set of audio I heard was further to the east. Here we go. Good morning, Battalia. All puffed up, fluffed up. There's a Battalia coming off the ground. I just saw another Battalia take off the ground. Now, one Battalia sitting in the tree in the early morning, meh. A Battalia coming off the ground, and there's a vulture coming off the ground. Now, of course, they could be glutting on termites, or there could be a potential kill around here. So a vulture and two Battalias is going to make me look a bit more carefully now. Another vulture. Okay, what's going on here, chaps? So we've got two vultures, two Battalias so far, two of them on the ground. Oh, they were on the ground. There we go, there's one of the vultures. Wonder if the vultures got confused, saw the bat there, thought they had spotted something. They could also just be eating termites. I'm trying to see if there's a big emergence. Looking for tracks on the road. I think they might just be eating termites. Well, let's carry on. Andre says he's got 6 cuckoos on his list. Now, let's go through the potential cuckoo species we get here. Andre said 6, so we've got African, European. We haven't seen a European yet that I know of. Great spotted, Levalance, Jacobin, Dedrick's, Classes, Black. Which ones are we missing? Emerald. Which is quite a rare one to see in this part of the world. Emerald. And then, of course, there you've got your vagrant species like the lesser and Madagascar, which only get seen once every couple of years. I think I must be missing one or two. I'll think about it. No tracks yet. Interesting. What you got? Another battle here. So there's another battle there. So there's lots of birds of prey in this. Oh, look, he's eating termites right next to us. Well spotted, Vim. So that's why we're finding them on the ground. They're eating flying ants. Even the vultures were getting in it. Oh, beautiful. That red face is absolutely spectacular. Catch him! Now, even these massive birds will put massive effort into eating termites. That's how protein-rich they are. Oh, there we go. Lion's calling again. Those are in Chitwa by the sound of things. Well, the trick is to see who answers. Definitely more ungainly on the ground than they are in the air. You see lots and lots of termites, but he's only after the alates, which are the flying ants. There we go, lion's calling again. Those sound really far away, like they could almost be in the Kruger. There's just so many lions calling all around us at the moment. Well, Julia, hello Julia, in Houston, would like to know, how do you spell alate? If I remember correctly, it's A-L-A-T-E, alate. A different stations, more Lion audio. Some of it sounds like it's possibly around Cruise Camp, and then more to the south, around Gari Main, maybe Chitwa. Now, speaking of someone who's hunting for lions, let's go see how Jamie is faring.
Well, at the moment, I'm trundling along Gowri Cutline, looking to see whether or not the lions are in their usual spot. Now, I don't know what's been happening in the 2 weeks that I've, or over 2 weeks that I've been away, but just before I went on leave, this particular area was basically like the Nkuhuma's home. They spent a great deal of their time in and around what we call a drainage line, which is essentially a river system, a very dry river system, with very dense vegetation off to my left here. And this was one of their favorite spots. And we really had got into the habit of moving very, very slowly along this road, just in case we could pick up a flash of their coats on the opposite side of the bank. I mean, that is not a lion. Definitely not a lion. On a day like today, of course, the chances are they're probably going to be moving and not lying down. I know that Brent has mentioned that he has heard the calls of lions, the roars of lions, all the way on Buffalo's Hook property, which is to the north of our boundary, and also on the southern side of our boundary, so on Chitwa somewhere, just south of Gowri Main, for those of you familiar with the geography of this area. And that's probably Birmingham Boys. Our Rexon, a name that will be familiar to many of you, Rexon is out also helping to look for them. He's gone to check on that buffalo carcass that we left yesterday. My suspicion is that they're not going to be there, though. I can't see why they would be. All of the meat was nearly gone when we were there yesterday. And I.A. Lewis on the subject now, I suppose actually for new viewers, all of that might have been very, very confusing if you're not familiar with the lions of this area. You want to know how many lion groups there are. I hope you won't judge me terribly. I'm going to show you a waterbuck whilst talking about a lion. Young male. Just want to see, just because he was looking quite alert, I just want to stop and have a look at his behaviour. Sorry, I.A. Lewis. Bear with me one moment. He's completely relaxed now. Young male, slightly waterlogged water buck. Of course, they've got the added advantage, unlike quite a few of the antelope out here, of the fact that their coat is waterproof, or relatively waterproof. It's covered in an oil that gives them a very particular pungent smell, and at the same time, sort of prevents the water from soaking into their thick, shaggy coat. They're much better adapted for being damp than most of the other antelope, and that's because in certain parts of Africa they actually spend a large portion of their time in water. Lovely. Nibbling away. And there's a bird that I want to draw your attention to. It is a tiny little bird on this knobthorn that's been pushed over. There we go, Brian's on it. Well done, Brian. Well, you got it briefly. I wonder how many of you managed to get a screenshot of that. How quick are you? How quick can you be? That was a male chin spot battis, and if we listen, we can hear them calling. Three blind mice, supposedly. And of course the black-headed oriole. The chinspot battis is one of the few birds where and I.R. Lewis, I know I was in the middle of answering your question and I will get back to it. I've got the attention span of a 8-week-old puppy. I will get back to that. But the chinspot battis is one of those funny little birds that the male and the female's actually slightly more brightly colored than the male. I'll show you now what I'm talking about. This is a chinspot battis. tiny little bird. That's the bird that we were looking at, for those of you who perhaps missed it. The sighting was so incredibly brief. Brian did very well to have been able to put that on camera. This is the male here, and that was what we were looking at. The female's actually, there's where the name chin spot comes from. The female's got a little brown patch and a little brown collar. Beautiful little birds. I'm just reading their bird calls. It was a game of mine last time, just before I went on leave, to do literal readings of bird calls, of the way that ornithologists write them down in these books. And this chin spot batis says, tew, tew, tew. Oh, well, I'm sort of putting an inflection onto it. And see, wasn't lying about the three blind mice. Three blind mice. And harsh chirr, chirr notes. I do enjoy the way that these bird calls are written down. It's highly entertaining. And if you've never heard the bird call before, it makes zero sense. Right, let's go and move on and look for these lions. And answer poor IR Lewis, was it? Says question, sorry. You've had to wait a long time, and I do thank you. IA Lewis, not IR Lewis. IA Lewis. I do thank you for your patience. How many different groups of lions are there? Well, in the Sabi Sands and in the Greater Kruger National Park area, so this whole vast conservation area, there's about 2,000, possibly over 2,000 lions moving about. Even up to 4,000. I must get the exact numbers and the exact census, but you're looking at a good couple of thousand animals. In the area that we are in, that we are based in, and we probably traverse around about 2,300 hectares out of 4 million, so our little percentage of this world. We have the Inkahumas, which is 13 lions, 5 females, 8 cubs. We have the Styx, which is 3 females and a couple of new cubs, but we're still waiting to determine exactly how many there are. And then there are the Birmingham Boys, 4 large male lions. They're dominant in this area. We occasionally see a pride of lions called the Tsalalas, which consists of 1 tailless female, very easily identifiable, 1 young female and 3 young males of not quite, probably about 2.5 at this point. Sure, they are just flying ants absolutely everywhere. It's wonderful. It means more sightings like the one Brent had with the Battalier. Sorry, just an observation. Told you, I'm like an 8-week-old puppy in terms of my attention span. I am, however, housebroken. Anyway, who am I missing? Tsalalas, those are Matimba males. They have made the odd appearance every now and again. The Matimba males were 2 males that were dominant in this area. They were kicked out by the Birmingham Boys and moved south. I'm missing, oh, the Mungeans. The Mungeni pride, which is actually historically related to the Tsalala pride and part of a breakaway movement. There's quite a few sub-adults. I think there's about 9 sub-adults that are part of that pride. We hardly ever see them. Something's died here. Brian, while I've been away, has there been a kill somewhere here? There was one just in here. Okay, it did smell a little old. Yeah. I think that's what I'm smelling. Okay, that's what it is. And speaking of smelly things and the multitude of buffalo carcasses, let's head over to Brent, who has found another one. Or maybe he hasn't. Maybe.
So we've got lots of dead and dying buffalo around, and here's another one that no cats on it, just some vultures. Here we go. And the vultures are so fat that only one is feeding. Now, of course, one of the disadvantages for the vultures with this many carcasses, obviously it's a positive and a negative, is that there's so much carrion around that the hyenas and lions and whatnot are not feeding off all the carcasses. So as you can see, the vultures don't have the strength to really open up the skin, so they can only feed around the soft bits till it gets really rotten. And that's what's happening here. That you can see they've just opened up in the soft areas, and there's so many carcasses that the vultures are not even fighting over carcasses. So I've just heard there's two mating pairs of lions that we've been hearing in Chitwa Chitwa. So obviously the Sticks are busy planning the next generation. Okay, well, we're going to leave this carcass. Unfortunately, we are heading to the east. I don't know, I've just got an inkling that something's going to be afoot on Cheetah Plains. We are about to drop into the Muwanini River system. As you can see down here ahead, you can see that little drop. And unfortunately, it is one of the few places where we do lose signal, but while we do that, it sounds like Jamie's got a slightly prettier feathered friend than the vultures.
I do indeed, and I found another hornbill nest. This is such fun. Yesterday Dave and myself spent a considerable period of time with a red-billed hornbill that was feeding its chicks, or feeding the female maybe, in a hole in a hollow dead tree. Now, this hornbill, who has just disappeared off, now we have to play the patience game because this hornbill is going to come back to this patch on the tree. I'm not sure, Brian, did you see exactly which hole it was? I didn't either. And now, we just have to wait. And with this many termites flying around, I don't think we're going to have to wait long until we have an opportunity to see the hornbill return and feed his family. Now, it could be that he is just feeding the female, since when she lays her eggs, she goes into a hole in a tree, just like these ones, and loses her flight feathers to incubate the eggs. Or he could actually, she might have already got past that stage, regrown her feathers, and he might be just feeding the chicks. Might even have been a she. I didn't have a chance to stop and properly look. And now, patience game. And so far, Brian and myself have spotted at least four lions between us that have all turned out to be patches of dirt. Come on, Hornbill. Oh, you're a different... I don't want to get too distracted. Come on. Yellow-billed Hornbill, back you come. It's actually been so much fun over the last few days finding the different nest sites and spending a little bit of time watching the birds bring the food back, whether they be crested barbets, warburgs, and of course the hornbills. That's beautiful, Brian. When I was training to be a guide, my instructors would always used to call these, ask us what trees these were, these dead ones that are always so striking, and then say, no, they're dead dog trees because they've got no bark, and laugh every single time. And it still was never funny. It just isn't funny. But every single time, it got very predictable. Okay. Hornbill, you've got 15 seconds to return. Perhaps not quite as efficient as the red-billed hornbill of yesterday. All right, let's go and look for lions, since our hornbill is not playing ball. One more time? No. Okay. You know, Brian, as soon as you bring the camera back around, it's going to arrive. You just know it's going to happen. Well, maybe not. Nope, no sign of him. Sure. The smell of dead something is pervasive. Is that a lion I've spotted? No, that's definitely not a lion. That is an impala. Very far away. Oh, somebody, sorry, bear with me in 1 second. Standing by. Alex, I'm sorry. I copied only about 1 out of 5. Please, can you go again? I think you said you'd taller those in Gala. Okay, copy. The same position as yesterday, or where are they? Okay, copy that. Thanks, Rex. I'm going to start slowly making my way there. Do you think it's worth trying from the other side, or do you think that's not going to work? Okay, copy that. Thank you. Rexon has found the lions. And there's no urgency to racing off. He says that the visual is not fantastic. They're in the same area that they were yesterday, which is very, very dense vegetation. I'm just looking for an owl in the tree, sorry. So they're in very dense vegetation, but we're going to make our way there, slowly but surely. He's got a view of 2 females and 5 little, he says what looks like 5 cubs, but he's struggling to see. The question I was asking him, cursory glance. Nope. No well wishes needed for this particular herd. And the question I was asking Rex was whether or not we could actually try and come in from the other side of the river system, perhaps get a better view from inside there. The one thing that we have to our advantage today as opposed to yesterday is we don't have the large roof on. Good call, Brian, good call. Brian said he didn't think it was going to rain. I think Brian got that right. I promise you, you want a weather prediction, listen to the cameraman. And as we trundle along, Robin from San Diego, you would like to know if trundling is different from bumbling. Robin, trundling and bumbling are worlds apart, in my mind. Trundling, okay, now I've dug myself into a hole, because now I can't think of how on earth to distinguish between the two. Trundling is bumbling with a purpose. No, that doesn't make any sense either. No, it does. Trundling is bumbling with a purpose. Trundling along is when you're sort of half looking for something, but you're sort of stopping for everything as you go along. Bumbling is when you've got no idea exactly what you're going. You've got no fixed plan in your head. You are pure you are the embodiment of spontaneity. So for this morning, for example, I knew I was going to go and sort of look for the lions with a purpose. I had a route planned and everything like that to take me in a circle back to where they were. So I was trundling, but if I'd set off and at the spur of the moment almost flipped a coin and gone left or right, then I would have been bumbling. What do you think, Brian?
Yeah.
Is that a fair enough distinction? Ah, now Rob in Liverpool, you say if I get bored of the word trumble, no, trundle, I'm mixing up bumble and trumbling's a whole different story. But if I get bored of the word trundle, I can always use the word meander. Absolutely, I could. The word meander always makes me think of my childhood whenever we went to go and visit the Drakensberg Mountains and all of the signposts along the way that say the Midlands meander. Sort of, I imagine twisting and turning. So I think if we're gonna meander along any roads, it would have to be something like Twin Dams or perhaps Leadwood, where you do lots of turning of the steering wheel. But yes, thank you, Rob. Any other adjectives we can think of, Brian? Not adjectives, verbs. Ah, apparently some of our, speaking of our speech patterns, which I imagine you actually, some of you have a better grasp of our speech patterns than perhaps we do. It's such an automatic thing for us. But Aaron in New Zealand, I'm thrilled to hear that our South Africanisms are rubbing off on you. Aaron finds himself saying the words just now more and more frequently in the South African context. And of course, it's completely uniquely South African, and it confuses people around the world when they hear South Africans talking for the first time. Because, first of all of our, apparently, all of our vowels sound the same. I disagree with that. I think our vowels sound most distinct. But we also say things like... too loud. We often say things like, just now, referring to the future. So rather than, it happened just now, being the past, I will do it just now, means the future. And just now, and now, and later... all have slightly distinct meanings. I could say to Brian could ask me to do something and I can say I'll do it just now. Or I could say to him I'm going to do it now. And we'll both understand exactly what I'm saying, wouldn't we, Brian? Exactly what we're saying. We know what the time frame means, and I can't begin to tell you how it works because it's one of those things that defy explanation and you just have to be brought up with that way of speaking. But, Aaron, I'm so glad to hear that you have incorporated that into your regular speech pattern. Oh dear, Fran, that is something I've tried to stop myself doing. That is also a very true South Africanism. The word shame. Ach, shame. Ach, shame, man. For everything. It is so descriptive across the board. Ah, I see a lion. We say shame if something's cute. We say shame if something's sad. We say shame if we feel sorry for something. We say shame when we're laughing. It's just one of those words, much like my that being said phrase that I hang on to so reliantly, that I repeatedly use, or that South Africans repeatedly use. This could be very tricky, couldn't it, Brian? Let me explain to you why it is so pretty, although all the guests turn back to the lines, yes. This is why it is going to be tricky. There is but one entrance to our sleeping cats, and at the moment it is currently occupied. Huh. That's okay. We can give them a few moments to... oh, we can give them a few moments while we look at the bird life around us. We've got a nice combination of things up in the dead tree. Yesterday we spent a considerable period of time with our Warburgs. Now we've got a Hardy-Dar and a Warburg combination. Actually gives you a really nice sense of scale, especially for those of you who are South African. Look how much bigger the Hardy-Dars are than the Warburgs. Gives you a really clear idea. For those of you who have seen Hardy-Dars before and perhaps never seen a Warburg... oh, it's calling. I love that sound. Absolutely love it. And perhaps for those of you that have seen any type of ibis before, of the sort of medium size, really does give you an idea that Warburgs are the smallest of the eagles that we get out here. And they are beautiful. They're in my top five, I think, birds of prey. Not to be outdone. Come on, that wasn't a proper Hardy-Dar call. Ah, that is a truly South African sound. Right up there with the words just now and shame. The sound of a Hardy-Dar calling. I don't know why they're such innately comical birds. Called Hardy-Dars after the sound that they make. Hardy-Dar. Come on, do it properly. Were you far too occupied with your morning preening session? As a South African child, it is a sound that we are all intimately familiar with. Brian, can you remember a single summer's morning where there wasn't a Hardy-Dar calling in your garden?
Never.
Never, never, ever. We had a flock of them, or family of them, that lived in the trees outside our garden for years, and there was one with a messed up voice box. And I don't know what was wrong with it, but whilst all of them would sort of do the normal ah-dee-dah calls, he used to join in and go, which at 5 o'clock in the morning in the school holidays in summer was not appreciated at all, especially not as I moved further into my teens and valued my lions. Come on, do your proper call. awesome, Brian. There you go. How cool was that? Oh, and a hooded vulture on that note. That was absolutely awesome, Brian, by the way. Truly stunning camera work. Our cameramen are fantastic. Right, well, I think it's time for you to travel a good few kilometers, a little bit to the south and to the east of us. Let's head across to Cheetah Plains.
Welcome to the east down on Cheetah Plains. What was that there? We are now near three in a row pan, and I'm hoping maybe for some quarantine luck. Maybe that new pack of wild dogs could be around. The two male cheetah crossed through, but who knows, they could be back again. So, and I just wanted to come have a look at Cheetah Plains after the rain. It looks like they might have got a little bit more rain here. Oh, it's a goose, an Egyptian goose, that's what it was. There he is with some blacksmith lapwings. Wow. Oh, there we go, that lapwing there was a tiny baby when I went on leave and now it's flying. Still hanging with mom and dad though. Now, when I come to this part of the world, I have to look in this marula tree. Now, the amount of times quarantine's been found in this tree, and now that it's got some leaves, alas, no leopard in there today. And who knows, maybe the first baby impala of the year is going to be on Cheetah Plains. Now, the other thing that's quite nice about Cheetah Plains, it gives us access to a whole bunch of different bird species that we don't really see on Juma, down on those lovely open plains. But we're gonna head south first, down towards the Mala Mala boundary, and then head east towards the open areas. So I said there seems to be a bit more rain here overnight. There's a few bigger puddles. And one of the other things is we might find some wading birds on the pans down near the open areas. Maybe we'll get lucky. I'm really hoping we see painted snipe this year as well. And also, of course, one of the few places we see ostrich regularly. So who knows, maybe we'll have a flock of ostriches. And Aaron in New Zealand was hoping for an ostrich sighting. It's also quite nice after the rain just to go have a check of everything. This is the first time I've been down to Cheetah Plains since I've been back from leave. So just scoping it all out. What's that now? No. False alarm. I do feel like I haven't seen Inkanyeni in so long. And she is one of my favorite female leopards. And this is her part of the world down here. Absolutely gorgeous morning. Morning, Mary. Mary's wondering, do people live within the park or on the outskirts? And the answer is yes to both. For example, where we live most of our lives, inside the park at Juma. And Also, all the lodges will have people who live there, and then on the edge, well, on the western and southern boundaries of the Sabi Sands, people do live. There's some large communities, and a lot of people from those communities work within the park. So yes, there are people. Now, the eastern edge and the northern edge, no one lives in. The north is open to the Manuleti, another game reserve, and the east is open to the massive Kruger National Park. So even though we only traverse about 6,000 acres, the whole Sabi Sands itself is about 120,000 acres, but it's completely open to the Kruger system. And so we are open to, can you believe it? And I'm trying to remember exactly, about 8.5 million acres of unfenced area, all for the animals, Mary. And of course, it would be lovely if we could, but we can't drive all everywhere. But we do quite well with what we've got, and it is a spectacular part of the world. Here we go. We're now down on the most southern edge of our traverse. Now, just over this rise up ahead is where those big open plains are. And I wonder what wonders those open plains are going to produce today. Remember, this is a live African safari, and like Mary, you can ask us questions by using the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter, or you can pop an email to questions@wildearth.tv. Oh, off it went. Now listen to this, there's a properly nice little bird party around here. We can't see them, but you can just hear them. Hear that? That is a black-crowned chagra. Not doing his full call, but it is a spectacular call. You can hear some shrikes, some black-back puffbacks, some little seed eaters, maybe a yellow-throated petronia, white-browed scrub robin, hornbills. Okay, let's see if we can actually see some of these birds. There's a little dry river system here, and they sound to be close to the edge. Now, the chagra that's got that beautiful call, he's one of the harder ones to see, because he's at what we call a skulking species. So he skulks in around the base of thick bushes. See if we can spot him. Nope, I can't spot him yet. He's probably right at the base of one of those thickets. Beautiful. Yeah, don't fly away, don't fly away. The VMs. Oh, he's gone. Just took off. Yellow-throated petronias, or yellow-throated sparrows, but they have vanished. Now, the sun seems to be coming through a little bit, so we might get some beautiful light a little later. Now, there's another vulture. I just see one. And I said there could be just retired buffalo all over the place, but I think this one's just found a spot to sit. You know, white-backed vulture. Let's move on. Oh, and who's that on the way towards us? Could be Andrew, the head guide of Cheetah Plains, or it could be Michael. Oh, they spotted. Spotted something up ahead. Let's go have a look. No, looks like just searching like us. Morning, morning. Good, thanks. How are you, Andrew?
I was down in the rough bend.
Is anything that side?
Nothing. There's a lot of noise of construction, road.
Oh, okay. Thanks.
Nothing much. I was hoping for quarantine around.
Yes, I heard he was close to the boundary yesterday.
And then I'm going to go back to that down and see if he's still in touch with, otherwise maybe you should stop from there.
Perfect.
And then I'll give you guys a go, right?
Thanks very much, Andrew. Bye-bye. Cheers. So there we go. Yesterday, someone asked about when we have lots of, oh my goodness, honey buzzard, it looked like. No, it's a dark chanting goshawk. I thought for a second it looked like a European honey buzzard, but it's not. It's just a bit of a bedraggled dark chanting goshawk. Off it goes. Now, about what flood damage is the worst when we get lots of rain here? Well, quite often, most of the areas we try to be proactive, fix the roads before they need fixing. But if you have a serious amount of rain, a sort of real dumping, the biggest problem is the roads. So likely we're going to be seeing quite a bit of road maintenance while we're driving around at this time of the year. Now, James is wondering, do the rivers flow with the rain? If they do, it will be very, very short periods of time. They don't flow constantly. They've never flown constantly. That's one of the things about these little sand rivers. They'll flow for an hour or two. If there's an incredible amount of rain, maybe four or five, and then they'll drop down. Fingers crossed that our luck is better than Andrew's as we come across into the large open areas. Oh, can we see anything? Can we see anything? Not yet. So Andrew had the same idea as me. Have a look for Mr. Q. What is here? It is beautiful nonetheless, even if there are no animals out on this open area. Now, of course, as the grass gets a bit longer out here, it's going to attract wildebeest and zebra. I wonder if we're going to see my old friend who I haven't seen in so long. Gnomeless Gnome in the Gnu. There we go. There he is. Hello, Gnomeless. There we go, Gnomeless ruminating away. And you might hear some large noise ahead. And that's what Andrew was talking about, a bit of road maintenance. Beep, 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 beep. And let's try to get past. Let's get away from the noise of the road maintenance. Oh, Yeah, some big and heavy machinery around. And Catherine's wondering, does the air smell great after the rain? Indeed it does, Catherine. It's very clean and fresh and smells like everything's new and growing. So, here we go. You can see the road maintenance. Certain areas, depending on the soil, needs more maintenance than others. So an area like this where you've got clay soils quite close to the base is going to need quite a bit more work than an area up on the crest that's got granite soils. As you can see, hello, there's large machinery. But let's go away from machine cats and to real cats with Jamie.
Real and very sleepy cats in the form of some of the members of the Nkuhuma Pride. One lioness, lioness, lying with one very full belly, full of buffalo. Sorry, guinea fowl alarm calling. It's hard to tell at the moment whether or not the guinea fowl are actually alarm calling or if they're fighting. The reason I say that is that it's their breeding season. Sorry, I just had to stop and listen to that for one moment. Let's go back to our lovely lioness. As I said, belly full of buffalo, as you can see, and looking well and truly content, and really not like she's going to be going anywhere anytime soon. And then, happily, since yesterday we didn't have a chance to see them, one large bundle of cubs. And I can't begin to tell you how many cubs there are there. I think there is about 5 of them. But I'm not 100% sure. It is very difficult to tell where one furball begins and ends. Little mounds of breathing fur. So cute. All tucked together for warmth. I think they had quite a chilly evening last night, being rained upon. Isn't that adorable? All those little chests and backs rising at different times as they breathe. Terribly, terribly sweet. Oh, there's one. Yep, I think there's 5 there. The others must be further into the drainage line or into the vegetation itself. And they just look so incredibly comfortable and give us a really lovely view into the bonds between a different lion, or between members of the lion pride. These cubs are going to be inseparable as they grow up, and then of course the females will be part of the pride, the males will be off on their own with each other. Either way, the bonds are incredibly important. And after a night of being drenched in the rain, which by the way is really very positive, them being soaked to the skin is a really positive step forward in terms of helping them recover from the mange. The more rain we have, the better for their skin condition. But it would have made them feel particularly chilly, and you can see they're still a little bit damp, and hence the reason for being cuddled up together for warmth. Such a sweet picture. Unfortunately, this is what is known entirely as a one vehicle sighting only. As you saw earlier with Rex, it's now our turn, but we will have a limited time to spend with them. Once the other vehicle makes its way in here, we'll have to pull out in order to give them the spot, because honestly, there really is nowhere else to go. However, I'm going to go forward a little bit so that hopefully we can see the male, whom I think is lying up just a little bit to my left. Now, there we go. We had a relatively easy job this morning of catching up with these lions. Hello, my girl. Don't mind me. Oh, goodness. Short of nose planting into the tamburti, I don't know how possible this is going to be. Hello, tamburti. That's it, I'm afraid. That's as far as I should go. Otherwise, we are going to do some damage, which I don't want to do. Now, we've got a male lion, one of the Birmingham boys. No idea which individual this is. I honestly can't tell. And I don't want to hazard a guess unless he lifts his head. The one Birmingham boy, where on earth are the rest of these lions? They must all be... Oh, goodness. We're going on a journey, Brian. That's definitely not where we want to go. Yank the handbrake up, but I honestly think it's just the soil slipping out from under us. Somewhere in here, the rest of the pride must be hiding. But this is a completely impenetrable area. There's absolutely no way for us to get further in here. So for now, we will make do with the view that we have. One, two, trying to do a head count, but it's impossible. Fiona, you wanted to know what the situation is with the mange. For our new viewers, perhaps you've just jumped on board and you've missed out on the entire drama that has surrounded it. So mange, and Fiona, sorry, I'm going to go into a bit more depth. I know this isn't necessarily exactly what you were asking, but we'll go into more depth for our newer viewers as well to explain it thoroughly. So the situation with the mange... When you're quite finished, Franklin. Mange is a naturally occurring disease. It's obviously carried by mites that infect the skin of the different animals. There has been an outbreak of demodectic mange, rather than sarcoptic mange, in the various animals around this entire reserve. We've seen that some of the impala are infected with it. I've seen some of the inyala infected with it. It is a very naturally occurring disease, and it flourishes during times of drought. And it is very, very sad to see the impact that it does have on some animals. And we've lost the entire group of Styx cubs, or the first group of Styx cubs, all eight of them. Most of them succumbed to the mange. One of them apparently had a very, very unfortunate encounter with an elephant herd, which does occasionally happen to lion cubs. They do every now and again get trampled. There are so many dangers out here for these little guys. The decision was made because the mites that carry mange and the entire situation is a naturally occurring disease in this area, and the lion population in this particular part of South Africa is entirely stable. And to have too many lions, because mange is all part of the natural ecosystem that helps to control the number of different animals, and to have too many lions automatically places the rest of the ecosystem at risk. So the decision, and as well as the fact that to treat them would have been more disruptive to their natural way of living than to actually allow the disease to take its course. Unfortunately, the Styx cubs proved not to be particularly resilient to that type of mange. The Nkuhumas, on the other hand, who have contracted it, probably it was spread through contact with one of the Birmingham boys, just because they're a common, it's not their fault, it's just because they're a common link between the two different prides. That being said, it could, oh dear, having mentioned that, that could also be a coincidence. The Nkuhumas, however, seem to be showing a far greater resilience to the mange itself. Whether or not that's because the cubs were slightly older when they contracted it, or whether it's because the Nkuhumas have done a slightly better job at providing for them in terms of food, I think it's more actually a natural genetic resistance, and the fact that they're older. They seem to be kicking it relatively well. And I have to say, I've seen a vast improvement since I've been on leave. And I'm hoping that we will continue to see that improvement. And then you've got to factor in the knowledge that whichever individuals survive this mange outbreak will be the ones that carry a gene that will be in some way resistant, or at least strong enough to fight it off for future generations of lions. So that's the, Fiona, that's the entire situation with mange. Betty, you've asked a question that I've been asked before, and I desperately went digging around for information about it, and I struggled to come up with anything. You wanted to know whether or not animals like elephants without fur fall victim to such skin conditions, and whether or not they have some other skin conditions that they get. I've tried to look into this to see whether there are any species-specific types of skin disease, particularly where elephants are concerned. I haven't been able to find anything. I did fall down a rabbit hole of all kinds of interesting medical disorders with skins of various wild animals, but I didn't find much on elephants, and I've also never found any evidence of elephants contracting mange. And that makes sense because, as we've said, mange is a mite-based disease, so it's based on a tiny little creature that inhabits the hair follicles. An elephant's skin is very, very thick. Although it is important to remember that elephants are not bald. They do have hair. They've actually got quite a considerable amount of hair. It's just quite sparse in terms of its covering. Very, very bristly. So I think the mites probably struggle to actually get into that particular patch of hair. I did look it up in terms of genetic or other species-specific types of skin disease that elephants get, and I haven't honestly come up with any answers there. Now, I don't know if any of you know of any skin diseases that are specific to elephants. I know there is, specifically with black rhino, they, during the summer months, almost all of them start to develop weepy sores in the folds of their skin, and that's because they attract a certain type of fly that then spreads bacteria. And again, I can't remember the name of that skin disease. It'll come back to me. But elephants, I don't know. I have never seen an elephant with a skin disease. Okay, Sleepy and Kahumas, I think it is time to leave you, make space for some of the other vehicles. But before we do, Ginny, you wanted to know if any of these animals get fleas on the subject of various parasites. Yes, but very occasionally, they're far more likely to carry things like ticks. It's important to remember that an animal like a lion is a parasite-ridden bundle of fluff. They really are. They are absolutely covered in parasites. They've got internal parasites. Their fur is covered in bacteria and mainly ticks that tend to outcompete the fleas. So we don't get much in the way of flea outbreaks, but they are around. There are some. But it's far more likely to be ticks that affect the animals. And I'm just looking at the cubs. They seem to be okay, although they probably are covered in ticks if we were to have a closer look. But looking at the female, she's got quite a heavy tick infestation underneath her tail. And I don't think we should dwell too long on it. We'll have a brief look and then move out. But just to give you an idea of just how many ticks are around that particular soft area of her body. Oh, gives me the shivers. Let's not dwell too long on that. Oof. And yes, parasite... Sorry, girl. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to insult you. Parasite-ridden animals. And it's important to remember, if you ever find yourself in a situation where you're hands-on with a lion, you'll find that vets and all people involved in moving lions around, darting lions, for whatever reason, everybody wears gloves. And whenever I've handled lions, I've always had gloves on, or immediately gone to wash my hands, because you just do not begin to know the amount of parasites they carry. Now, Daniel, you wanted to know if I've ever cuddled a lion cub. And yes, I have, when I was a small child. I have cuddled a lion cub. They were brought to the school that I was in many, many, many years ago. This was before we knew better. Not that I'm excusing that. And I did cuddle a lion cub when I was a child. In fact, most of us as South African children of my generation did have that opportunity. Do I agree with it? Absolutely not. Did I know any better? No, not then. Now, however, we are gearing more and more towards the knowledge, and this is very, very important as to just how bad cub cuddling truly is. A real conservationist is not about cuddling animals in any way, shape, or form. A conservationist is a true conservationist is about the survival of a species and an ecosystem as a whole. Cuddling cubs, for those of you that are new to this concept and you see it as a very attractive prospect, it must be lovely to go and cuddle cubs in breeding centers that claim to be helping the lions. Just bear in mind that those cubs that you've cuddled are ripped away from their mothers long before they are ready to be removed from her. They are constantly handled by human beings, which is as different from their wild reality as it can get, and then they can never be released back into the wild. So don't ever believe that that is possible. A lion that has been raised by humans or has even become used to humans cannot be released into the wild, and as a result, they get sent to canned hunting industries. And do not buy into the lies that the cub petting facilities tell you. That no, they're different, because they're not. It is in no way helping anybody to go and cuddle a lion cub, and it's actually grossly unfair on the cub itself. And I wish I could go back in time and tell my 10-year-old self, or however old I happen to be, that that was the case. I can't, but I wish I could. But at least use that experience to warn those of you in the future. Brian, do you remember they used to bring those animals around schools? Mm. I can't remember what it was. Obviously, I'm actually not going to give out the name of the organization that used to do it, but they'd bring all kinds of things. Little owls, little scops owls, all sorts of things, hedgehogs. And in a way, it was entirely well-meaning. It really was. It was a genuinely well-meaning thing to take these wild animals to children who might not have the opportunity to see them in the wild and to educate them about it and to try and explain just how valuable these creatures are and to develop that interest in wild animals. Which is understandable, but doesn't have any real sway in the real world, which is why it's so wonderful that technology has got to the point that we can bring you a live safari with wild lions, not touching them, not impacting them in any way, and we'll be able to take those across the world to, which is why I love our school program. And on that happy note, we are going to leave our beautiful lions uncuddled, unmolested from us, leave them sleeping peacefully and make some space for some of the other vehicles. And while we navigate out on a slippery way, you definitely don't want to cuddle him, Brian. I really wouldn't want to cuddle him. But while we navigate our way out of here, let's head across to Brent and see how he's navigating cheetah plains.
Well, so far, Cheetah Plains is quite quiet this morning. Very beautiful, lovely and fresh, lots of bird sounds, but not too much on the large mammal front. So we've done the old Kruger boundary. We're now on the Nkoral boundary. We were hoping for any sign of Mr. Q, quarantine the male leopard. No luck so far, so we're going to start meandering back up to the west and towards Juma again, but we're still deep inside Cheetah Plains. And the wonderful thing about being on a live African safari is you never know what's next. Oh, and there's a very fast moving next. If we go, he's gone. There's a little steenbok. This is the area where quarantine was seen yesterday, but outside of our traverse area. Hello, Tracy. Now, Tracy's wondering, do we get to travel outside of the Sabi Sands or outside the park to see different animals and go to different areas? We definitely do, Tracy. Normally on our leave, last year I've traveled all over the place. So up to Zambia to look at black lechwe and shubels in the Benguela swamps. I mean, right up to the border of Congo. And where else did I go last year? Trying to think now. Oh, I went up into the mountains in the Eastern Cape. That was more of a fishing excursion. But yes, we do, Tracy. On our leaves, we do tend to travel. VM is a great traveler. VM has got his whole setup. He's very mobile. He's got a mobile house he has with him. VM, where did you go last year? Kalahari?
That was this year,
Kalahari. There we go. VM's done the Karoo National Park, the Kalahari. Lots of Kruger, and then VM and I went to Makuyu Park, which is up in the north. So yes, we do travel to go see different areas and different animals, different birds. I'd say VM is probably the most prolific traveler of us there. Oh, VM's spotted a sleeping diker. Will it sleep or will it run? There she is. Hello, little one. Now, actually, it's so awesome that she's keeping still. Now, you can see all the flies around her face, but just below her eye, you can see a little black line. Now, on both sides, those are glands that she'll use to scent mark in that. Oh, shame. Those flies look very irritating. But yet she keeps still. I think we're going to start experiencing flies now after the rain. If we start beating ourselves on game drive, it's probably because there's a little biting fly on us somewhere. Bye-bye, little diker. I said the sun's coming through, but there is still quite a lot of cloud around. We could definitely use a little bit more rain. Okay, no sign of Mr. Q. So I know you've seen the one Birmingham boy with Jamie this morning with the Nkumas. The other three are all on Chitwa Chitwa, apparently. Two of them are mating and a third just hanging about. Oh, looking. It has been rather quiet down here on Cheetah Plains this morning. I wonder where Mr. Q is hiding, or Nkanyeni, or Tundi even. Now, we sort of moved out of Nkanyeni, the female leopard's territory. This area here falls within Tundi's territory. I haven't seen her in an age, and I'd love to catch up with her and possibly see. Oh, you see that, Fem? Coming across, flying high. Where are they gone? There they are. What have we got there? Black-bellied bustards. Oh, massive flying bird there, the black-bellied bustard. A relative of the koran, except much bigger. So we've seen quite a lot of red-crested korans recently, but we haven't seen too many black-bellied bustards, and they're often nicknamed the champagne bird. So when they do a call, they go like a champagne cork popping. Very distinct display, and I'm pretty sure we're going to see a bit more of it come the summer months. Now, of course, we're looking for the first baby impalas, the first woodlands kingfishers. Well, the woodlands, I think, are a bit late this year because of the lack of rain, so maybe this bit of rain we've had is going to bring the woodlands out. Now, quite often they'll arrive, and for the first couple of days they don't call. But I think in at least 2 weeks we are going to be inundated with the chirr of the woodlands kingfisher. Now, a lot of you have been asking about wildflowers, and as I said, it's going to still take a couple of days before a lot of them come into bloom after the rain, but I'm very excited for the wildflowers to come out. Alina in California has asked, do we have a balloon flower milkweed here? Well, we do have milkweed, and the balloon refers to its seeds, and it gets a very spiky balloon ball, can be quite big. Now, Alina, they do attract monarch butterflies, but you must be very careful. They have a very, very poisonous milky latex, and it's one of the plants that the monarch butterflies get their noxiousness from. Now, what I did spot was some beautiful purple flowers in a tree. Look at that. And I think, look, there we go. Isn't that pretty? Now, I think the purple flowers should be today's nearly impossible tree quiz. Haha. So there we go. It's quite a big tree with the purple flowers. You can see very distinct leaves. And if we have a look at the bark, bam, there we go. There we go. Quite distinct bark. Very distinct bark, in fact. So that's today's nearly impossible tree quiz. What tree is that? I'll accept scientific as well as common names. There we go. Today's nearly impossible tree quiz. If you know the answer, questions at wildearth.tv on email or hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. Oh, impala, are there any little ones? Doesn't look like it just yet. Any day now I'm expecting to see bounding little lambs with legs too long for their bodies. Oh, I can hear some guinea fowls. They're a bit far away for me to hear whether they are alarming or they are just filled with joy. Now, at the moment, they're splitting off into pairs to breed, so there could be some arguments over the ladies between the different males. I'm just going to have a quick look on the open area in front of Cheetah Plains Lodge. Oh, here we go, I can hear them. Come on, be a leopard. Sounds like they're just up here somewhere. No, unfortunately, I think it is fighting over the ladies. But always worth checking. Where are they now? They've gone quiet. Well, anyway, we can't see them just yet. While we investigate further, let's go back to Juma and see how Jamie's faring.
Jamie is in the process of attempting to navigate around that fallen tree that has proved to be quite the obstacle on Twin Dams. Are we okay there, Brian? Surviving. Uh-oh. Sorry, Brian. There we go. The one thing about moving through trees on a day like today is, of course, you get soaking wet. There we go. That was actually easier than I expected it to be. Came upon another herd of impala, still no sign of babies, and they all dashed off into some very dense vegetation. They're quite nervous, and I think that's probably just a product of the morning after a scary night for them. Lots of rain, it's dark, it's windy. Perfect hunting time for predators. Oh, we've left the lions for now to make space for Mike from Cheetah Plains, and we are trundling once again. No, we're bumbling, actually. Remember how I said trundling had a purpose? Now we're just bumbling in the hope that we bump into something exciting. Where are all the elephants, is what I would like to know. They've clearly been around, and lots of tree damage, including the one that's currently blocking the entire road. And where on earth are they? Here's an important little lesson as we go through this muddy patch. For those of you that perhaps haven't driven in off-road conditions before, as we go up this hill, you'll notice just from the tire tracks that it's very, very slippery and very muddy, and you can actually see where animals and vehicles have slipped along this road. And this is where it's quite important, because you don't want to actually wreck the roads out here and make ruts that when the mud dries, they're going to be difficult to navigate. You can see something slipped there. It's quite important to make sure that you maintain a sort of a constant power so that you don't over-accelerate. You can go up the hill quite slowly. It's not too slippery. But you don't put too much power in or suddenly stop and then try and accelerate some more, because all you're going to do is spin your wheels in the mud and create these deep, deep ruts, which is something we would far rather avoid. You'll notice that we're avoiding certain roads as well. Places like Mvubu Road and Yala Road South, those are all closed to us after rain. Oh, it seems as though Brent has been more fortunate than myself and has found a bird for you.
Look at this, it's one of the little cuckoos that is normally very well hidden, but due to the termite emergence, they're out in the open. I wonder who... Oh, off he went. Now, that looked like a Deirdrex, but I think I saw a Classes as well. Let me just go back, see if I can spot. Now, there's one that we're missing. Somewhere around here. Oh, it's done a disappearing act. Oh, hang on, what's that there? Where are my binoculars? No. Oh, there with a caterpillar of him. Through, up, on the other side of this, behind it. Oh, there's a stick in the way. Is that, oh, is it a Classes? I couldn't see, where'd he go? Oh, is it a Deirdrex? He went there. Where'd he go now? He's in there somewhere. There he is. Oh, he's got a hairy caterpillar. But it is a Deirdrex. Oh, look at that. Now, the cuckoos love caterpillars. So, it looks to be, I'm trying to see the eye. Now look at that, cleaning its beak after feeding. Wasn't that incredible? Now, James is wondering which cuckoo species has the largest sexual dimorphism. Oh, it's quite a difficult one. Most of them are quite similar, but it'll be one of probably, I'd probably say the African emerald cuckoo. There we go, that's the male and the female. Now, a couple of the others, like, I think what's next should be here. There we go, Deirdrex as well, which we've just seen. And then again, oh, no, that's not a cuckoo, that's a Makua. Where's the Classes? There we go. And there we go, you can even see he's got a caterpillar in his mouth. They really are fond of caterpillars. Okay, well, we just, on our way through, just one last check, see if we can spot anything. Alas, not. And alas, that little dip ahead here is not a great area for signal. So while we head back towards Juma, let's go see how Jamie's doing, and hopefully one of us can find a Classes cuckoo shortly.
Our Classes cuckoo is very much on my list of birds I would like to see this season. I've heard them a few times, that call that is written in the books as Mariki, Mariki. And it's they've got to be in this area somewhere in the dense vegetation of the drainage line. The problem with the cuckoos, like the Deirdrex cuckoo that you were looking at with Brent, is that they're quite secretive birds. They're not like, for example, that crested barbet that I could hear, and you almost immediately know that it's going to be sitting somewhere prominent, as it is, trilling away happily. The cuckoos, especially the green cuckoos, tend to be quite shy and hidden in vegetation. They don't sit up and display themselves like the birds like crested barbets and lilac-breasted rollers do. Look at that amazing trill. You see the speed of the vibration of its larynx vibrating away. And of course, we've spoken about this before. The crested barbet able to Oh, gone. Able to maintain that drill for more than one lung full of breath by virtue of the fact that it can practice circular breathing. Breathes in through one side and manages to breathe out and trill through the other. Fascinating system. And relatively unusual, even in birds. And vanished off now. It's a beautiful morning for birding. I think Brent's absolutely got the right idea. Let's see if we can't find another one of the cuckoos. This is what I was talking about with bumbling. The joy of spontaneity. I think we're going to go right. And actually, I have one reason for wanting to go right, and that is that Aubrey called in that there were tracks of a male leopard moving through this area towards Treehouse Dam. And gives us the opportunity to look at how full Treehouse is looking from the rain. And Treehouse Dam, Treehouse Waterhole, is usually one that fills up quite well because it sits at the bottom of a natural seep line. So all of the water that's collected in the soil and that hasn't been soaked up by the plants will push forward and flow down into Treehouse Waterhole itself. But we'll make our way there very, very slowly, stopping to check for any sign of the Queen of Juma. And hopefully, chance to see this male leopard that's walked through. Now, Liz, absolutely, isn't it crazy? Liz says it's crazy how the leopards seem to disappear every few days. I'm still smarting from the other morning when Brian and myself happened upon really fresh tracks for Karula and her cubs. And I know that they were not, they can't have been far. Those tracks were so incredibly fresh. And we just didn't manage to find them, despite the efforts of three different guides, myself, Taxon, and Aubrey. And we just didn't have any success. And Tingana yesterday was on Torchwood. So he's done his usual, which he often does, his thing of potentially walking straight through Juma over the night. I'm impressed with Aubrey that he managed to find leopard tracks on a day like today. Because tracking is not easy after it's just rained. Especially when it comes to leopards. But listen, I think it's time to break our leopard streak. When was the last time a leopard was seen on our live safaris? Brian, any idea?
Not that long ago.
Okay. So they haven't been gone for too long. They haven't abandoned us completely. And there's always the knowledge as you drive around areas like this that somewhere there is a leopard. We can almost guarantee that there is a leopard on our traverse area, whether it's on Juma, Arethusa, or Cheetah Plains. It's just a question of finding it. It's amazing also how old habits die hard. And places where you've seen leopards in the past, you always find yourself going slightly slower and just double, triple checking that they're not there once again. Which isn't that bad of a habit to be in, because especially with females with cubs, they often will leave their cubs in a place that is familiar to those little ones. Places where they know that the cubs know the escape routes, they know which trees are good to climb, so that they feel slightly more secure in leaving them all alone. This is one of Karula's favorite hiding spots for her cubs. Apparently she crossed further south. She went onto our southern side of our traverse area. But it didn't look like the cubs went with her. Ninus, you wanted to know, talking of mysterious animals, since I was chatting earlier about the fact that the elephants seem to have disappeared as well, you wanted to know if I've seen Fang's herd since the birth of that gorgeous little elephant. And for those of you that missed it, we actually were fortunate enough to see an elephant that was myself and Jandre, largely thanks to Brent, who managed to find that placenta that was very, very fresh. And we managed to see a brand new hour-old baby elephant, still wobbly, still not quite dry from the whole birth. And it was with a herd of elephants that very, very easily identifiable by a female that I suspect is the matriarch that we call Fang, because she's got a recurved tusk. It points backwards. It's grown backwards and curves towards her leg. Doesn't do her any harm, but it does make her very easily identifiable. I haven't seen that particular herd, but I know that Taylor did. She did see Fang and the little baby probably about a week or so after we had that very special moment with the new baby. So it was seen, but I haven't seen it since. And in fact, I think I've only seen elephants once since I've been back. And if I'd known it was going to be the last sighting in a while, I probably would have stayed with them for a little bit longer. But I was rushing to see if I could catch up with a lion. I really feel as though it's time to see an elephant. Okay. Apparently these tracks of this male leopard cross and move towards Treehouse Dam. Let's just go and see. Well, hopefully we get lucky. It's going to be very difficult to track him on the soil, but perhaps we'll get lucky. A very good morning to Mike in Richards Bay. You want to know, we've spoken now about mange at great length. You want to know whether or not I can tell you whether anthrax is present due to the drought. I haven't heard of any reported cases yet. However, oh my goodness. Actually, these leopard tracks are really very clear. I'll show you in a second. But Mike, you're absolutely on the right track in that anthrax does tend to rear its head, so to speak. I say I'm going to try and show them to you. Now they've disappeared. Hold on a moment. Sorry, Mike. Now they're not. No, these have been rained on. They're almost completely invisible in patches where the sand's not quite as malleable. And now they've disappeared and vanished completely. Sorry, Mike. Distracted by leopard tracks. They are going this way, though. We'll keep an eye out for him. But after rain, or before the rain, I mean, he could actually have moved an enormous distance since. So, Mike, we haven't heard of any recorded cases. But as I said, Mike is absolutely correct in that anthrax does have the outbreaks are more common during a drought. And we're very careful at this point. Whenever we find a carcass that has been that is dead for no apparent reason, and it could be the buffalo that we're seeing, we're always exceptionally careful. We don't go up and touch it. We try not to interfere with it in any way. And we also report all sightings of carcasses that have not got an explained reason as to why they are there. And what I mean by that is no lions sitting on them, for example. It is a naturally occurring bacteria. It's fascinating, its resilience, in terms of surviving for many, many years, just as spores. It's a nice lilac-breasted roller. Stop for 1 second. See him there, Brian. He is, if we look along the into that silver cluster leaf, he is. I'll show you now. You'll see him as he moves slightly, little bit to the right. Wait, where is he? I've lost him. Oh, there we go. Well done. Oh, well done, Brian. Bravo. Beautiful birds. Looking bedraggled as most of the birds are at the moment. In fact, all of the animals of Juma. How's that turquoise blue? Very fetching little bird. And as I said, tend to be a lot more prominent on the ends of branches, much like the crested barbet, rather than hiding away like boo-boos, shrikes, and of course the elusive cuckoos. Okay, nice opportunity for just some screenshots for one of the prettiest bird with probably the ugliest call. Their call does not suit them at all. When you look at a bird like this, you imagine it to have some sweet lilting melody, perhaps like a nightingale or something similar, or robin. Instead they go wah, wah, and off he goes. Oh, nest. Another one. Oh, look at that. How cool was that? Surprise. That was definitely a surprise, wasn't it, Brian?
Yeah.
It's also amazing to watch birds. There it goes, back in. Fit into holes that do not look big enough to fit them in. Like cats. So, right, we have found many hornbill nests, crested barbet nests, magpie shrike nests, and this is the second lilac-breasted roller nest that I've found since I've been back to work. It's definitely a time of lots and lots of little babies. And there's another nest to keep an eye on. Well, chances are she could well be incubating the eggs at the moment. The fact that the male, and that probably is the male that has been feeding her, went across to feed her, the fact that the male's been bringing her food. Let's just see whether or not he is as industrious as the male hornbills that we've seen. Perhaps he's going to go and catch something more for her. Here he goes. Awesome. No. Gone much farther afield than the hornbills usually do. Well, that was awesome. Another nest for us to keep an eye on. Remember when Scott found that nest in the marula tree and we were able to watch the fledglings? It'll be nice to keep an eye on that nest as we move further and further into summer. I'm going to go and search for Tingana, just in the hope that we get lucky. Meantime, I think that our journey in Cheetah Plains is complete and that we're back on Juma once again.
Yes, well, we are back on Juma, and just for those of you who have just joined us or might be a little bit late, my name's Brent Yeo-Smith. I have the incredible Vim on camera, and we are in search of everything. So I know Jamie's looking for Mr. Tingana. There were male leopard tracks around Treehouse Dam, so I think I'm going to give her a hand. I'm going to start from Twin Dams. I'm going to drive up the southern boundary, make sure he hasn't managed to sneak out. Oh, it looks like we're about to have a traffic jam. Let me just move out of the way here. Morning, morning.
Hey, man, how are you?
Good, and yourself?
I'm good, thanks, man.
How's it? That's hello, hello.
Hey, on TV.
No, I'm on TV. any updates in the west?
It's just a little bit quiet. Quite busted there at Seforesto.
Wow! Oh, mate, that's worth going to have a look at.
Yeah, but it's the wind more.
Oh, of course he's gone.
So, yeah. You know, I was after it as well, but I missed it.
Okay. Yeah. Well, good luck. Enjoy the lines.
Cool.
Okay, off we continue. So, isn't that amazing? There was a Cory Busted spotted on Arethusa airstrip, but he's gone now. Might be definitely worth going to have a look for that on the Sunset Safari. I think, I don't think there's ever been one seen on Safari Live. If there has, let me know. Have we ever seen a Cory Busted on the live drives? Hashtag Safari Live, questions at wildearth.tv. Let me know, I'd love to know. Now, they do hang around sometimes for a while, so he might have been moved off now, but it might be definitely worth looking on the Sunset Safari. Okay, and we're going to cross through the raging torrent that is the Mawati River. I think I caught you all. So a lot of people saying tree wisteria. It's not. It does have purple flowers and tree wisteria, but this tree is not a tree wisteria for the nearly impossible tree quiz today. I'll see if I can see another one. It might not have flowers on it. Ah, now another guess in, a syringa tree. It is not a syringa tree. I think I've caught you guys. Finally. I thought I had you with the dwarf boar bean yesterday, and you guys were on it like a flash. So maybe, luckily for me, it keeps you guys going for a little bit longer to what the nearly impossible tree quiz is today. Now, I know I was the last person to drive down this road on yesterday's sunset safari, so if we find any leopard tracks here, I know they are between somewhere between last night and today. Justin. Justin's wondering, how often is a new species of plant or animal discovered in South Africa? Not that often. South Africa is one of the most widely studied in terms of those things. When a new species, probably not a new species to the world, occasionally we'll get a new bird species, a vagrant that's been blown by a tropical storm or an Arctic storm onto the land. New plant species, probably the most interesting place from a plant species point of view. I'm not sure if they've found a new one in the last couple of years, but is the Soutpansberg Mountains, which basically means the Salt Pan Mountains, which are to the north of us. Now, there are over 1,000 little species of euphorbia there, and those are quite often the tiny little lichens or euphorbias or things of the newest species discovered, but I haven't heard of one for a while. Now, the place where most new species are discovered with the most regularity is, of course, the Congo Basin rainforests, which are very little explored in comparison to the savannas of Africa. And most new species found in Africa these days are generally insects. Now, we've seen one giant land snail already this sunrise safari, but it seems like Jamie's found another.
I'm sorry. That was utterly hilarious. And I don't think that Kirst even realized that she did it. Here you go. Here is your lion's Jan snail. Okay. Lion Jan snail. Because she said she had no idea. Okay, let's have a look at our lion Jan snail for a moment. I can't laugh too hard, Kirst, because you know me. It's not like I don't do that on a regular basis. Sorry, I would have gone round through the front of the car, but I would have wound up trapped in the trees. Hello, lion Jan snail. How are you today? Now, the reason that it is called a lion Jan snail, or alternately a giant land snail, I'm not sure how big the one that you saw with Brent is, but this is a particularly large one. Look how big it is compared to sorry. It's okay. There you go, out you come. Let's do it this way. Look how incredibly large this particular land snail is. It's basically the length of my hand when it is fully stretched out. He/she, which I'll explain in a moment. So an incredibly big snail. They are favoured by local people in terms of eating them. I'm not a huge fan of even the idea of snails, so I'm not in any way vaguely tempted. And they're fascinating and actually relatively unusual to see one of this size. This snail has taken years and years to grow to these proportions. So it really is a truly impressive creature. No, not the land snail! Protected with my life as a vehicle comes driving past. Rexon and myself can't seem to avoid each other at the moment. And there we go, a giant land snail slowly but surely making its way across the road. Fortunately, I'm here to draw attention to it, but most guides moving very slowly are very, very conscious of the... Rex has just turned around, he's not having any of it. Very conscious of the presence of creatures like this, particularly after the rain. Gives you an idea of just how fast land snails move. Hold on a second. Oh, I'm not wearing my watch. We need to time this. Let's make a mark. Yeah. And let's say, how long is that? It's roughly 10 centimeters. Here we go, let's time. Maybe that was a bit dramatic. We might be here all day waiting for it. Okay, it's crossed the finish line. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, Okay. I'm going to guess here, because I can't be bothered to wait for it to get all the way to the finish line, that it's probably going to take about 30 seconds to cover about 10 centimeters. So what's that? That's about 20 centimeters per minute. That's its speed. In kilometers per hour, that would be slow, give or take a couple of units of measurement. You can do the math for me in a moment. So to cover about 20 centimeters would take the standstill about a minute. And the reason I'm drawing attention to that is, of course, because it all plays part of the reason that they're designed in the way that they are. When you move this slowly, imagine you are one lone land snail traveling along at this speed, tremendously fast. Oh, we've finally reached the finish line. There we go. Imagine you are a giant land snail, all on your lonesome, desperately lonely and in search of a mate. Oh, there's no such thing as snail Tinder out here or anywhere in the bush, and there's certainly nothing for them to be able to find each other. So when they do, when they have those rare encounters with each other, they absolutely have to make the most of it. Hence why I named it he or she. They're not hermaphrodites, but they do have reproductive parts for both males and females, so that when they encounter another land snail, each one can impregnate the other. Isn't that fascinating? And when you move like this, you can sort of understand why. Okay. Good luck, Mr. Land Snail. I'm not going to touch it or move it out of the road. Nobody's going to drive over it. We know where it is. It knows where it is. We'll just let it go about its daily business. Slow but steady. Is, however, very, very visible to birds, and this would be perfect prey for a bird of prey, any kind of a raptor. There you go, off you go. You can see with age, just last thing, sorry, you can actually see with age just how light the shell is going on the edges, how bleached it is becoming. And of course, we often find the dead land snail shells, white in color, standing out starkly in the mush. They're cool. They really are very cool animals. And I know they are a favorite among some of you. Okay. Bye-bye, snail. Amazing. Okay, I'm going to have to go all the way around the back. Sorry, excuse me. The way I parked myself. And goodbye to Kirsty's lion Jan snail, which is my favorite Kirsty comment to date. Lion Jan snail. It's even better than the time that I was meant to be going live and she said to me, 3, 2, 1, you're off air. I mean, you're live. She says, hee-hee, stop it. Oh, Chris, thank you for making my day. I'm going to go on either side of it, by the way. Cheers, little land snail. I promise you I put my wheels on either side of it. Very practiced. Brian, you can attest to the fact that it is still crossing the road. What was the question? Oh, yes. Vulpine Wolf Girl on the subject of our land snail, as it slowly moves off. He wants to know if these snails can be poisonous. To the best of my knowledge, no. I haven't heard of any of them being poisonous. There are, as Steph and myself discovered many months ago when I was on a bushwalk where I encountered several species I have never ever seen before in my entire life, and neither had Steph. There are quite a few exotic species of snail. I don't know whether or not they could potentially be poisonous to us. As far as I know, the giant land snail is entirely edible, which is unfortunate for it. It would actually probably be better if it were poisonous, just in terms of keeping it safe from hungry people. But no, sadly for the snail, it is entirely edible for us and for many of the creatures out here. Sometimes you'll even find lions eating them. It is a good question. Such a good question, you have flummoxed me. James, it's your question about whether or not do I think that they have evolved to move as slowly as they do, and if there is some kind of advantage to that speed of movement. I guess that a lot of movement, or a lot of predators, their eyes are attracted to sudden movements. We've seen the way that the birds hunt. You can see them cocking their head from side to side. Those of you that have watched certain documentaries with chameleons hunting, for example, you'll see how as soon as the insect move, that's when the chameleon strikes. Now, perhaps it is a way of fooling a predator into thinking that it is something that it isn't. Perhaps a rock that is slowly blowing in the wind, or so. I don't know how it works. Of course, they've got that hard protection of a shell, but I have to tell you that that shell is relatively flimsy and easily breakable. So maybe it is just to avoid predators, most of which will be attracted to movement. I can tell you a funny story about Lexi, my Weimaraner. Now, Lexi's a wonderful little dog. She doesn't... Initially, when she was a puppy, she wanted to chase... Not really chase everything, just play with everything, except lions. She knew immediately that lions were a no-go area. Obviously, that instinct's very, very strong. But Lexi has a thing about moving rocks, whether it's a land snail or a tortoise. She is utterly terrified of them. And she will not stop barking until you move the offending moving rock out of her vicinity completely. She goes absolutely insane because obviously she can't figure out what this thing is. It's a rock, but it's moving, and she can't quite figure out how the two fit together. And I've got a video of her barking relentlessly at a tortoise, but she won't go near it. She'll run up to it and then race away, barking furiously as soon as it moves. I'm not sure what that says about Lexi. She's either very smart or perhaps the opposite direction. I'm biased, I think she's pretty smart. I wish she'd do the same with snakes, though, and scorpions, although she's learned the scorpion lesson. While I do my cursory impala glance, no babies here. Heidi's a little bit confused about what I was trying to say about the land snails, which is fair enough because I don't think I explained it fully. You're saying, do they both get babies, and how do they both get babies? So when two land snails love each other very much, or more realistically, when two land snails actually happen to encounter each other, which is not often, what they will do is this is interesting. I'll stop here for a sec, but let me finish, Heidi. Let me finish my explanation quickly, and then we'll talk about this poor buffalo. So the land snail has both a male part and a female reproductive part. And I'm hesitant to call it a penis or anything like that because it's slightly different in terms of its design, but it is basically the equivalent, and basically the equivalent of a vaginal tract. And they produce both ovaries and sperm, or the equivalents thereof. So what they do is when they meet, they essentially fertilize each other. Very unlike the process of the mammals, like this buffalo, which of course is the more conventional process with which we are more familiar. Poor girl. She's missing a horn. Completely. That has broken off. I have seen one female buffalo before on Arethusa, watching this ox picker dig into her ear. Can you imagine what that feels like, Brian? What that sounds like for an animal with such sensitive hearing? I don't blame you, girl. But speaking of ox pickers, I have seen one female buffalo with a missing horn around Buffalo's Hook Dam. Brian, were you filming with me, or was it VM? I think it was VM. I think it was during one of our rehearsals. And this poor female buffalo, her horn had broken off, and obviously the ox pickers, because it is living bone at the base, the ox pickers had started eating away at the bone marrow. And they, to the point that they'd made a cavity that the ox picker could actually disappear into in the base of her horns. I can't begin to describe how disturbing it looked. This buffalo's not so bad. That would have hurt. Don't get me wrong, when that horn broke off, it would have hurt. It may have been while she was running away from something like a lion, and she snapped it off on a tree in her momentum. Look, thinking about it. Obviously hers is not quite deep enough for it to get in there. So once again, another tiny herd of buffalo. And almost invariably, that's because they've been chased by lions at some point. That's it. Is it just the three of them? I think it is. Yeah, I think it is just the three of them. So a breeding herd, for our new viewers, typically consists of at least 50 animals, usually more, that we'll see, although they've been slightly more sort of spread out in slightly smaller herds, just in terms of coping with the drought and there being enough food to go around. But when you see a group of buffalo like this, if it includes a female, as it does, then chances are she's been separated from the rest of her breeding herd by being chased by lions. And she can remain separated from the herd that she came from for the rest of her life. She might not ever find them again. And she might just decide to rejoin with a different breeding herd of buffalo when she does encounter them. And off she goes. Very, very distinctive with that broken horn. And keep an eye out for her. One, two, yep. Two females and a little one, now that I've got a slightly better view. So I can almost guarantee they've been chased by lions. I'm going to move on and move further to the west of Juma. Brent has taken that idea into the extreme and is on his way towards Arethusa.
Well, we decided Cory Busted is not something to be trifled with, so we're going to try. It's a long shot, but our plan is to go past the airstrip and then move back towards the airstrip. It might be in that crest around Central Road in Arethusa. Fingers crossed that we get some Cory Busted luck, and you never know. That's the last place we saw Anderson as well. To see if anyone can hear me on Arethusa. Morning, mobile stations. Any updates for Safari? But fingers crossed, Cory Busted. As I said, I've never seen them in the northern Sabi Sands. I've seen them in the southern Sabi Sands. They generally prefer bigger open grasslands. So I always thought if we were going to see one, it was going to be a cheetah plains, not on Arethusa. But that's the thing about the bush. You never know what you're going to see, and things can just arrive. Well done to Judy H. and George Ann, who got the nearly impossible tree quiz correct. It was an apple leaf or a rain tree, and the scientific name for Phalaenoptera valencia. And there we go. Here's one of the most successful warthog moms we see regularly on the Arethusa airstrip, and she's managed to raise four little piglets to adulthood. Done such a good job. Now, look at that incredibly long white whiskers. Now, that's quite an interesting thing why they're there. So, while the pigs are young, their whiskers seem to be far more prominent, and it's to pretend to be tusks. So, it looks almost like a tusk, even though it's just a wonderful set of whiskers. As they get older, it'll thin out. Here we go, onto knees, get down to the roots, to the bulbs. And we do see this warthog family regularly here around the Arethusa airstrip. making sure we're not up to any nonsense. The rest of them have got down to the business of breakfast. Can start seeing the little tusks. Look at that nose working, sniffing for the succulent spots. Okay, well, pigs, we're in search of the world's heaviest flying bird, so we'll see you later. Marie says she's very happy that I changed my mind to look for the Cory Bustard. As I said, it is a long shot, but I think it's worth it. Maybe our luck will hold. Okay, so they said it went west from the airstrip. So we're going to go now past onto Central Road or to track last and then move our way through the crest. Maybe we'll get a sighting of it. So apparently very, very long time ago, a Cory Bustard has been seen, but only once. So hopefully we can make it twice today. Definitely not one been seen since I've been with a Safari Live. Now, it's amazing. So I've just been listening to the Game Drive radio. Everyone is desperately searching for elephants. Now, with the rain, those elephants have dispersed. I mean, I'm not even seeing elephant tracks at the moment. What bird was that? Look there. Oh, there it goes. Oh, one of the cuckoos. It was too quick. Let's see if we can get another view of it. Oh dear, it looks like it's disappeared completely. Kingfisher, did you see a kingfisher?
Maybe.
Oh, VM thinks he might have spotted a kingfisher. Is it a roller? It's a roller. Oh, just the electric blue. Now, I wonder who's going to see the first Woodlands kingfisher. Now, we're going to now start scouring the central region of Arethusa for the world's heaviest flying bird, the Cory Bustard. While we do that, let's go see what Jamie's doing back on Juma.
I think the chances of us finding a Cory Bustard here, at least on Juma, are relatively slim, but you never know. I think I might just try and get the first Cory Bustard on camera for this season. Brian, have you ever seen a Cory Bustard?
I have.
Oh, you would have seen them on Swalu.
Yeah.
You would have seen a few of them on Swalu.
I think I've seen one.
Have you seen one here?
Arethusa.
Okay. It's a bird that I'm dying to see here. They are such, whoopsie, turned on my indicators. Such fascinating birds. I do feel as though, Brian, we need to beat Brent when it comes to finding the first Woodlands kingfisher, though.
Yeah.
At least. We'll try and see if we can spot one that isn't a roller. Interesting that apart from, and I mean yesterday and the day before, these areas were teeming with general game. It's interesting that there's hardly anything. Apart from impala, I think I've seen one waterbuck. And that's it. And just goes to show how as soon as it rains, just how dispersed these animals become. They're not forced into an area. They don't have to worry about going to a waterhole for water. There's lots of puddles that will suffice. And it completely changes the dynamic of the area that you're in essentially the space of about 24 hours. Well, here's something. Hello, gnus. I love watching wildebeest. Here's another animal to be on the theme of babies to be excited about at this point. Probably not just yet, though. They've got another month to go before the births are imminent. Last year we had a live wildebeest birth. Got Kirsty. Whatever Kirsty has is contagious, apparently. Brian's filmed a live wildebeest birth. How many of you filmed, Brian?
Only one.
Only one. Only one. I'm gonna aim to make it more this year. Last year I spent, I think, somewhere in the region of about 9 hours with a wildebeest herd. And then the final three, we had that live birth, and it was absolutely magical. Some of them are starting to bulge ever so slightly, showing the odd sign of pregnancy. And I know that we seem baby-obsessed, but I promise you, those of you who are regular viewers will understand completely the magic of a live birth. And those of you who are new to the whole thing, you will understand shortly. Our wildebeest calf, when it is born, is a completely different color to the adults. A much, much lighter in color, which I assume is a product of an attempted camouflage. It doesn't really work, actually. And in fact, the wildebeest calves in this area, at least, seem to stand out far more than the adults with their lightish colored fur. They're actually almost the color of a lion, if not even lighter. And they look completely different, but oh my goodness, are they fun to watch. We've seen on cheetah plains before, we've seen on Juma before, the way that the wildebeest play and chase each other around, and the females running around in circles around the male. The calves are even more fun. They dance and they skip, and then they go to sleep, and then they get up again, and then they dance and they skip some more. They're absolutely gorgeous. I can't wait for wildebeest calving season. And personally, despite their weird look, and they do look very odd, they look like a weird mixture between an antelope and a cow, even though they are full antelope. Here's one from last year. That's a baby from last year. I personally find them to be one of the most entertaining antelope to watch. And they're actually quite fun if you sit on foot in an open area where they can see you, and you sit on a termite mound or something and you go, you see, now they're looking up. Some of them are looking up at me. I'm not the world's best wildebeest caller. Yeah, not so much, huh? But if you do sit and do that for a while, they're quite curious antelope, and they'll actually come and walk up to you, and they'll start calling back at you. It's hilarious. They're not into it today, though. Not even vaguely interested. And that probably wasn't my best. Brian, can you do it? You're better at impressions. It is infinitely better than mine.
They're not keen.
They're not keen to play today. They're not keen at all. How very disappointing. Oh, well. Next herd. You do start to look a little bit odd, though, if we were to just sit here. To the objective eye, perhaps, that wasn't watching the live show, somebody driving past find us both sitting here going, starts to look very odd. All right, Voolies, if you don't want to play, we'll leave you alone and go about grazing. Lovely question on our sunset safari. Robin, you wanted to know what the word safari means, and if it's only Africa. No, it's the sunrise safari. You see, Kirsty, it's your fault. I blame Kirsty for this. She's twisted all of our brains so that we can't talk properly. Sorry, Robin. Sunrise safari. This is the morning. It's when the sun comes up. The sunrise safari. He wants to know what safari meant. It means journey. And I think it's of Swahili origin, unless I'm very much mistaken. And I think it's a beautiful word. I think it's beautifully descriptive of the whole process of a safari. And he wants to know if only Africa uses it as a term of description. It's actually, funnily enough, in South Africa, we don't refer to going on safari. We actually talk about going on game drive. We don't really talk about going on a safari. Or at least, personally, that's how I always talked about it when I was growing up. You went to visit the bush and you went on a game drive, which is very South African, game drive. But yes, I think as far as I know, it's of African origin. It's largely based around African safaris. But I don't know whether it's something that's been expanded now with the growth of tourism in different places and the growth of interest that people have into different areas, that perhaps you could go and do jaguar safaris, you could go and do tiger safaris. So it's a word that's been used, that has started to take on a greater meaning, but is always really in the context of nature and going on a journey in nature, essentially. There you go. Just for those of you that are in the know, correct me if I am wrong. I'm relatively certain it's a Swahili origin word. But now I've started to doubt myself. Sorry, elephant tracks. Big bull elephant, but not fresh. Not worth following, unfortunately. And very indistinct, otherwise I would stop and show you. But in light like today, it's not going to be very clear. Thought it was Swahili in origin. Just have, every now and again you have those moments of self-doubt where something you've known your entire life suddenly becomes a question again. I'm sure you're all keen to find out what is happening with Brent and his search for the heaviest flying bird. Let's go and hear how he's doing.
No luck on the crest, which I'm hoping that maybe it's popped out onto the airstrip again, but it's not looking too promising at the moment, unfortunately. I don't see anything. We'll try a little bit further down the airstrip. All I see is the normal inhabitants, the lapwings, and some Egyptian geese. And a stick. There you go, just checking. I can hear him calling. There he is, on the far right there, Vim. I can hear him. Whoop, whoop, whoop. Whoop, whoop, whoop. Well, there's Buffalo Weaver as well, building its nest. And you hear that calling. There he is, African hoopoe. He's puffing up his neck. We're pushing air through to do that call. Such a pretty call. Hoop, hoop, hoop. Hoop, hoop, hoop. Looking for the ladies. So they're birds, yeah, but alas, not the world's heaviest flying bird just yet. I haven't given up, don't worry. We've still got quite a bit of the airstrip to do. Whoop, 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 whoop. Come on, Corey Bastard! the binoculars at the ready. This looks like more like Cory Busted country rather than the thicker areas, so he might have moved in to a slightly more open grassland or woodland around here. I think it's going to evade us. I think he's moved on. Now, Anna Marie is wondering, what is a Cory Busted's call? Now, it's quite a deep call. Let me just find it for you. So for those of you who don't know what a Cory Busted looks like, there we go, that's what he looks like. The world's largest, or heaviest, sorry, flying bird. And his call, sorry, let me just find, there we go. I've got to put it under my hat. It's a funny sound, isn't it? Almost like a cough. Now they generally do that when they're displaying to each other during the mating season. There we go, that is the Cory Busted's call. Very strange one. Oh. Oh. Almost sounds like Karula calling the cubs. That Cory Busted has done a disappearing act. Oh, hopefully it's back. I think it's probably just moving through, and it's probably going to keep moving through. Moving with the rain, looking for lots of fun things to eat. Now, Cory Busteds are quite endangered. So during the 1800s and the early 1900s, they were shot extensively for food, because they're not very fast moving. And apparently very good tasting, according to some of the Bushman trackers I've worked with in the Kalahari. They say Cory Busted is mwah, nice, very nice. Okay, so unfortunately, our Cory Busted search was a bust. And let's go back to see, back to Juma to see what Jamie and Brian are up to.
The endless joy that we have with the various Busteds of this area and their somewhat amusing names. Sorry, I'm just stopping to look at this flock of helmet shrikes. I'm hoping we can get them on camera. Has been something of a birding day this morning. Oh, you cheeky thing. All right, well, it was worth a try, wasn't it, Brian? It was. A flock of white-crested helmet shrikes. You always see them together in this area, and they can be fascinating to watch if they would just sit still for more than 1 second at a time. Now, just bear with me 1 second. I need to do an update on the game drive comms. I haven't heard of any changes. I've just found Nkonzo 4, 1 Minota Ingwe going north into the block from Balanites, just a little bit to the northwest of the repeater. It doesn't look like the tracks come out on Impala Road, but it's so damp I might have missed them. You may or may not have heard me. It is uncertain. Oh well. But that message there was that I found tracks of Tingana, so he went all the way from Treehouse Dam, where we had him earlier. Sorry. Maybe from last night. Looks like there might have been a little bit of rain on top of them. But they're on top of most of the other Nkonzo of this area. Okay, copy that. Thanks, Rex. I didn't realize she'd been seen in that area. Whenabouts was that? Okay, copy. Thanks very much, Rex. Right, well, that was interesting information, something that I don't think any of us realized. Karula didn't cross south yesterday. The lions got crossed somewhere along the line. The female leopard that we, of course, are always on the lookout for with her two cubs, she was actually seen on Juma yesterday morning, but on the boundary with Torchwood, which, of course, is our eastern boundary, not our southern boundary. So I think there was just some confusion there about which boundary she was on. But apparently she was last seen moving onto Juma, which is really exciting prospects for this afternoon sunset safari. Rex sounds determined to try and find her. More buffalo. Having done the updates on our leopards, I think I've missed his tracks. He usually walks this path on his way out. Sorry, let me get us a bit closer to have a look at this buffalo herd. The whole new range of bumps here, Brian. I know, I'm sorry. Bouncing around on the back there. Hello, buffaloes. Another small group of them, slightly more than the last herd that we saw, but probably about, I don't know, 7 or 8 individuals here. So still, again, probably an offshoot from a herd that got chased by lions. These poor buffalo are having a really rough time of things, although at least it's rained. For them, it is looking up, looking much more positive. In the next 4 or so days, we're going to see the impact that the rain has had. We'll start to see more grass coming through, a little bit more for them to eat. And, of course, they're not forced to visit the same waterhole day after day that actually has water in it, which means that they're not necessarily going to make themselves such easy targets for the lions. And I'm sure they're quite happy about that particular aspect. And speaking of happy animals, there's another vulture. Let's go and have a look. Happy and very full scavengers at this time. The hyenas haven't even bothered with the carcasses on Juma. They've obviously got plenty on Manuleti to keep them occupied. And the vultures are sitting very happy, very fat, with very full crops. Which is great for them as well, because of course it's also, and it's not just the breeding season of the little passerines, it's also the breeding season of birds like this white-backed vulture. And we'll probably find there, after this drought, there's a population boon. James, speaking of very full vultures, of this one's actually doesn't have a full crop. You want to know how quickly a vulture can digest a full crop? I have absolutely no idea, James. I really honestly have no clue. My guess would be somewhere in the region of about 24 hours, but that is a pure guess. And I'm actually going to turn to those of you with birds, although it's a difficult one because I doubt, highly, highly doubt that any of you have pet vultures. They're not exactly something that's in demand, are they? Actually, I think a pet vulture might be quite cool. They can clean up the scraps of dinner. No, I'm joking, of course. We don't keep wild animals as pets. But those of you who perhaps have had birds as pets in your lives, maybe you can traject. There's a little one for comparison. How long would it take a vulture with a full crop? I have absolutely no idea. I am baffled. I'm going to guess and say 24 hours. But I'm opening it up to those of you. If a vulture weighs roughly somewhere in the region of about 6 kilograms, which is just over 12 pounds, I don't know if you can maybe try and work out how fast it would work with other birds. Although it's a difficult one because, of course, it's an entirely different food structure to, or food system, to most of the birds that are kept as pets. Things like parrots and canaries and so on, all seed eaters. Don't think it would be quite the same. So James, you have asked a question that has caught me out, and I'm going to go and try and find out and see if I can work out exactly how long it would take for you. I'll have to try and give you an answer on the sunset safari. I would say they work, their digestive system works quite rapidly. And of course, metabolism of a bird works very, very fast. That I do know. Their heart beats incredibly quickly, so it must be quite a rapid process. So while I puzzle over the maths involved in how fast a full crop disappears, let's head back across to Brent for an update.
Oh dear, that unfortunately the Cory Busted search did not come to fruition. So we are back on Juma now, and hopefully we're going to have a little bit of luck in the last few minutes of drive. You never know what's around the next corner. And of course the most exciting thing is we're going to be doing it again in a few hours for the sunset safari, and who knows what wonders will await us then. Now, Taylor says she's never seen a snake on the show. Well, Taylor, we do get snakes, and now that we've had a bit of rain and summer's out, we might get lucky enough to see. Strangely enough, the most common snake we've seen on Safari Live is the world-famous black mamba. But you're wondering what the python's up to. I'm sure the pythons are around. Only seen one really big python, and that was in May last year, and nothing since then. But I'm sure they're around. If we're lucky enough to find a spot where one likes to bask, we might see them a bit more often. Now, I used to know about a spot in the southern Sabi Sands where after rain and a bit of sunshine, you could almost find a big python sunning itself on the edge of a termite mound. But alas, we haven't found such a place up here in the north yet. Now, we've also seen, sand snakes. We've seen variegated bush snakes. What else have we seen, Vim? Oh, red-lipped herald. Oh, blind snakes. Oh, hello. A very dark female giraffe. No, it's a male with very small horns. And just looked like a female just because their horns weren't too big. It's quite a small male. Very dark. It's probably quite old. Let's have a look. Yes, you can see not the most prominent horns on that male. There you go. You can see a bit of battle scarring on his face. Oh, that funny nose. And there we go, ruminating away. You can actually see the ball in his cheek of a food that he's brought up from his stomach. Now, quite often when you watch for a bit, you'll watch chew, 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 and then he'll swallow and bring up another one. And see that sideways action of a ruminant. Non-ruminating animals, jaws go up and down. Ruminants go from side to side. There we go, boomp, there we go, down. Next one coming up. There we go, roomp, up. Isn't that cool? There we go, yes, you. There we go, so obviously the ruminants have four stomachs and they're able to change the boluses. The bolus is that ball of vegetable matter that he's chewing on at the moment. So once they've digested enough and broken it down to get the most nutrients out, they'll swallow and bring up another. And what this does, it ensures they don't have to feed constantly or in search of food constantly. So they might eat quite a lot and then they'll stand and do not much but ruminate like this guy is doing at the moment. Did he just swallow another one? No. And just took a break from chewing. Well, Mr. Giraffe, thank you for that. Always lovely to see. Funny looking creatures they are. Okay, we are coming towards the end of the drive. Is Karula going to make a magic appearance? No one's seen her in a few days. It is proving quite tough for leopards at the moment, but fortunately we do have those incredible Inkahumas that are resident on Juma at the moment. Unfortunately, with this rain and the spreading out of the herbivores, buffalo and zebra and wildebeest and such, our lovely lion run might be in a bit of trouble. Now, it's quite a strong possibility when the buffalo and a lot of the other animals move to the north, to the basalt plains on the edge of the Manyaleti, and the lions are going to follow. But while they're here, let's make hay while the sun's shining and enjoy them every day. And of course, with the onset of the rains, there's all the wonderful little bugs and butterflies and birds, tortoises and terrapins to have a look at. As I said, we'll see you again in a few short hours for the fantastic sunset safari. But from Viam and myself here on Juma Private Game Reserve, it's been absolutely marvelous, and we'll see you a little later, but let's go across to Jamie for the last bit of the show.
And for the last bit of the show, I owe a deep debt of gratitude to Asko, who looked up, Googled, exactly how long it takes a vulture to digest its full belly and crop. And the answer is actually not far off from what I guessed, which I said a day in 24 hours, and apparently it is 30 hours. So there you go, James, the answer to your question, and thank you to Asko for sending that through, because without you, I would not have had a clue. I obviously would have gone and Googled it when I got home, but it's nice that we can share that information now with all of us and with all of you watching. And that is the joy of the interaction of the live safari, is that we can all learn from each other. And I have learned a great deal since I started working here. And one of the, I think one of the most special things in terms of learning about each and every, or from each and every viewer that sends through information, is actually learning and prompting me to go and learn myself about animals outside of my sphere of comfort. So the animals, the birds, the things that you have in your backyard, those of you fortunate enough to have things like bears and so on, animals that I dream of seeing. It is an exceptional learning experience. I honestly don't think how, can't begin to imagine how we might top it. Speaking of topping things, last minute or so, last minute and a half, do we see any babies? No. I think this is the same herd I stopped at this morning, to be honest. I'm not going to tell any stories here. This is definitely the same herd that we stopped for. So we've come full circle from the start to the finish of the sunrise safari. Lovely to hear from you, Joshua. In the last 60 seconds of our show, you say this is your first time here and you'll definitely be coming back. Thank you, Joshua. It's lovely to have you on board, and we look forward to your questions soon. Right. Thank you, Brian, for your wonderful camera work as always. Sorry, we're going to do a very rushed closing. Oh, it's not so rushed. We've got 30 seconds. Whew. Can calm myself to a minor panic, as well as to Kirsty and to Jerry in final control. And most importantly, a big thank you to the Thumb, of course, for all that the Thumb does. The Thumb is an invaluable member of the Safari Live team. Don't you think, Thumb? And as another one, thank you to all of you for your questions and your comments. I'll see you on the Sunset Safari. Bye-bye, everybody.